Hey everyone, and thank you for joining me on another episode of Talk Nerdy to Me. Today I'm joined by our Chief Information Security Officer, Ryan Weeks. Ryan, thank you very much for joining me today.
It's great to be here.
Now, you've been going to a number of different partner events recently. Have any themes emerged from those conversations at all?
Yeah, there's, I've been fielding probably hundreds of questions since DattoCon and also doing the Cybersecurity Summit series, across the states and up in Canada. And there's kind of, a bunch of these questions fall into kind of two themes or two buckets. The first common question or common theme is, what should I be doing to secure the systems that I deploy, the servers that I deploy? And then the second question is, I have firewalls, I have antivirus, I have web filtering, I have, intrusion detection systems. What other controls should I have, or should I be looking at? What's the next thing that I need in order to keep my end users secure?
Now, Ryan, where would an MSP start to answer those questions?
It's usually not a direct answer. My belief, and I think what a lot of MSPs are really asking for is, how do I understand the threat landscape that my end users are facing? And I think that the end users are, definitely depending on their industry, they might be subject to, certain types of adversaries. Certainly, if you're in like financial services or some one of the highly regulated industries, they're likely going to attract a more advanced adversary. So what I really prescribe is understanding the environment that your end user the industry your end user is in, understanding the threats that might face them. And from there, you can kind of derive a general idea of the control sets, right? If your end user is facing a specific class of threat, maybe it's more advanced, you probably need redundant layers of controls that are more advanced. And if you have an end user that's basically just a target of opportunity, they're going to need a basic set of well-performing controls. Maybe not, probably still want to go the defense in depth route, multiple layers, but maybe not as intense as, if you have an user that is going to be constantly subject to those types of threats. So really for me, it all comes back to doing a risk assessment, having an understanding of the data, and having an understanding of, the environment that end user operates in. And I think only from that point can you really start to decide what controls make sense for that end user.
Now, Ryan, how would an MSP go about understanding the threat landscape?
Usually, understanding the threat landscape comes with years of acquisition of knowledge, experiences, having things happen, reading articles, seeing people reverse things. So the first thing I suggest is you should definitely subscribe to some sort of daily news feed, whether it be the SANS Storm Center Stormcast or CyberWire, great podcasts. And have some, maybe you monitor Reddit, NetSec, something where new information about the evolution of threats is being kind of populated on a daily basis. And that'll kind of help you acquire over time. But if you need, if you have a pressing situation with an end user right now, and you need to like front load that information really quickly, and or you just want to make sure that your analysis is complete, MITRE put out a framework called the Attack Framework. And what it actually does is it helps you walk through specific types of threats and how they manifest and what the outcomes are. And it really helps you kind of model out the behavior of a threat actor and the given types of threats. And generally what you can do from there is decide what controls make sense for those types of threats. So you can actually go through the exercise. If you understand the data, you understand the systems, the access, you can start to map the types of threats that might exist for that end user and their systems onto that kind of understanding. And then that's where you start to be able to build on. So I have this understanding, now I have the threats, now we get to start to have the conversation about the controls that you can lay over top of that.
So that's really your foundation.
That understanding of the end user is the foundation. Then you have to really understand the threats on top of that. And those two things is really the base knowledge that you have to have before you start deciding the controls program that you want to put in place.
Now, what would a risk and controls assessment look like to you?
So we start by asking basic questions. Well, what is the data? Where does the data live? How is it accessed? Who has access to it? And then from there, we can model the threats based off of that surface, depending on how it's accessed or what the data content is, what its value is, So we can map the threats onto it. And generally, again, using the MITRE ATT&CK framework, you can also walk through an exercise called threat modeling. You can use a framework. You know, some of these frameworks are actually very easy to adopt. Microsoft has a threat modeling framework. You can also use a threat model called STRIDE or DREAD, STRIDE or DREAD, DREAD. And those actually help you walk through that modeling of that threat onto that. So that's right. Again, we said we have the understanding of the systems and the data. Then we have the threats. The threat model helps you really kind of build those two things together, right? And then from there, I think, you know, that's one half of the equation. Then we said we'd layer the controls on top of that. And rarely are we starting from scratch with controls. You know, we usually all have some basic level of control, even if it's process or policy. We should start by mapping the controls. You know, before we decide anything new, we should make sure that we have the basics and the foundation right. So we should map the controls that we have today onto some existing framework that helps you make sure that you're taking a complete approach. So something maybe like NIST or ISO, could even be a framework of your own making. I've talked to MSPs that have actually built down their own framework and their own kind of risk framework and controls framework that they kind of use for all of their end users. And I think that's great, right? You really have to figure out what works for you. But if you don't have the knowledge or the time to build your own framework, there's you know, a half dozen or more different frameworks out there you can use. So I think, you know, definitely do your threat modeling, ask yourself the questions about the data, because that really informs your risk analysis. You know, definitely consider mapping your key controls that you have today onto a framework, because that can also help you identify some gaps.
Now, Ryan, you'd mentioned basic controls. What are the basic controls that MSPs should have implemented?
Yeah, so MSPs, and I think everybody in technology, like, we always are interested in what the latest and greatest is. And that's like, you know, what's the next, that's the basis of that theme, right? What's the next control that I should be looking at? But like for me, it's you got to get the basics right. You got to get the fundamentals right. So you know, we need to look at the basic things first. Do you have firewalls in there? Ideally, they're probably some sort of UTM, Unified Threat Management Gateway, or some sort of next generation firewall. You should have some, you know, some sort of web filtering, you know, to prevent your users from hitting the known malicious stuff on the known kind of threat URLs and things like that out in the space, and prevent those known attackers from trying to touch your systems internally. Definitely have antivirus, even if it's just basic antivirus. It's not the most effective, but it still does prevent, you know, kind of the what I like to call the internet floor, like the really basic, easy to catch stuff. And there's still a place for antivirus in a basic controls program. You should have your, you know, with ransomware, we all know you should have your backup and disaster recovery. You should definitely have some sort of identity and access management solution. So really we're talking about some sort of single sign-on or 2FA. Users can traditionally be pretty poor in their credential management practices. Yeah. So I think if you can provide them some sort of identity and authentication solution that really makes it easy for them to get it right, that's really kind of a in my opinion, that like kind of single sign-on and 2FA has kind of made it into the basic bucket. It's kind of table stakes now. You have to have something like that. So that's on the control side. And then there's also like a whole bunch of like basic process that you need to have. Like, you should be patching all of the systems, especially the ones that are directly exposed to those given threat surfaces, whether it be the end user machines that are browsing the internet or receiving emails, because, you know, people love to click on stuff that they shouldn't. Or if it's your internet-facing systems, that maybe they're web apps or, you know, just anything that's internet-facing, all of those things should be patched, you know, 100% of the time. You should be backing them up as it makes sense based off of, you know, what the tolerable downtime is for a given end user. You know, so just making sure that you have, like, the right basic process in place. You know, maybe you'd do a penetration test once a year, or if not a penetration test, with a third party, vulnerability scanning of those systems, just to make sure that you're not presenting any material vulnerability out into the world. Because sometimes, you know, if you have even a basic vulnerability, you might have the most secure like controls in the world, but if there's a, you know, one unpatched service that has a really easy to exploit flaw, that you just become a target of opportunity at that point. Like, they're just out there mass scanning for these things. So you just got to make sure that you're kind of constantly vigilant about what the view of your end user systems are out into the world, and make sure that you have those basic processes and basic controls in place and working well before you take on any sort of advanced control.